So, welcome to this session about quantum computing. We are very happy to tell you a little bit in this context of Société Got Talent about what we are doing and what we are working on in the area of quantum technologies. With me here is Julian van Velsen, who is leading the effort on quantum technologies within Capgemini. Hi, Julian.
Hello. Thank you, Michiel.
So, why don't we start with the big news? So, I think the most important thing that we have accomplished over the last couple of months is that we are going to establish a Q-Lab or quantum lab within Capgemini. And I think that's a huge, huge step. So, what it would be is a centralized lab where we are going to explore quantum technologies and what it means for Capgemini. And we got the go-ahead from Ayman Ezzat, our group CEO, to start building this competency, to hire people, to get talents, to do research. And so that's a quite exciting news, Julian.
Absolutely. I'm very thrilled. I think quantum technologies is an amazing technology, right? And this is going to be so impactful for the group in almost all of our business units. So I think that the sign that we are really taking this serious at the highest level shows that, you know, we are preparing ourselves for a future and that this can be a huge step towards becoming more quantum ready.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, then of course, we should take one step back, Julian. And first, before we start discussing what this quantum lab will be about, maybe we should say something about quantum technology in the first place. So how is quantum, what do you think, how is quantum more than just much faster computers?
Right, so there's a whole variety of quantum technology. Some of them, you know, we may already have for a long time. For example, atomic clocks that we use in GPS satellites to very carefully measure your location. But using that nanoscale quantum phenomena, we can do a multitude of technologies. So we have indeed computers that leverage like the very weird nature of how atoms interact with each other. And we build very specialized, very extremely powerful computers with these. But it's really important, and I can't stress this enough, is that it's a very specialized type of computer. So they won't replace classical computers in any way. It's not just a GPU or something. It's something that is even more specialized, that can do certain things of computations extremely fast. So really think about replacing wind tunnels with quantum computer simulations, right? Like doing all the computational fluid dynamics, things that take HPC, high performance computer clusters, thousands of hours to calculate, we may be able to do with quantum computing.
And then you would do it in just a couple of seconds, right? That's the idea. So for very specific computing tasks, for very specific problem areas, you would increase the speed with orders of magnitude, but it doesn't mean that it will change all kinds of computing, right? So for other tasks,
absolutely,
a quantum computer is not suitable. So it's you really have to choose very well on what kind of problems you're directing quantum technology.
Yeah. Yeah. So this exponential performance gain, this is super difficult to get your head around, right? Like it's not 10 times better or 100 times better. It's exponentially better for a certain class of problems,
uh-huh,
which means that if we have a very large problem, it's exponentially faster. So it means that really from billions of years for certain type of applications to seconds.
So if I understand you correctly, quantum computing is really directed at problems where you have this this combinatorial explosion, right? So where you have a very quickly by adding problems or adding nodes to a problem, the number of possible answers grows exponentially, and then a quantum computer, it's able to calculate much faster which is the best solution or something, for instance, in a traveling salesman problem.
Absolutely. So indeed, the traveling salesman problem, where you had all these different routes where you might go to. The problem may seem simple at first. You only have a bunch of cities where you want to travel to. But if you look at all the different combinations, it's becoming extremely difficult. But maybe more important at the near term are problems where you can think of interactions between electrons to simulate drugs or to simulate materials. When there is interaction between all of the particles in your system that you're trying to simulate, it explodes in the number of states that you can have.
Yeah, and so until now, those kinds of simulations were practically impossible because you had too many combinations. And so what quantum computing does is that it makes previously unsolvable problems solvable, and it makes hard problems easy to solve, but within a very specific problem area, right? That's important.
Absolutely.
I think for the people to understand. Now, in addition to quantum computing, as you show here on this slide, we also talk about quantum security and quantum communication and quantum sensing. So maybe you can say something about what that is all about.
Right. So one of the things that quantum computers are extremely good at, unfortunately, is to break encryption. Encryption is based on some mathematical formula, and this is something that we expect that quantum computers may be very good at.
Yeah, so a lot of encryption nowadays, it's based on a hard mathematical problem that with quantum computers suddenly becomes easy to solve, right?
Exactly. And the problem is, of course, that this type of algorithms, this encryption, is everywhere, right? We use it now when we're using this video stream. We use it when we have a hardware device and there's encryption in it. We use it in our, all parts of our life. So this is where we have to change towards new and better mathematical formulas that will still save us from this quantum threat. And if you take that even one step further, in the end, we will also be able to create encryption that is based on the phenomena from quantum mechanics. So new types of quantum encryption. And you can imagine that at some point we will not just connect classical computers to each other, but we will also connect quantum computers to each other and really build a new type of internet, a quantum internet. Uh-huh. that relies on new type of encryption and quantum encryption, and in the end maybe all kinds of exotic new applications that you can build with these type of security.
Yeah, so what I find this quantum security problem fascinating, because on the one hand, of course, today we don't have the powerful enough quantum computers yet to actually break most of encryption. But we know that somewhere along the line in the future, these computers will be powerful enough. And then depending on who you talk to, it can take 5 years, it can take 10 years, it can take 20 years. It's quite unclear still when this point will be reached. But then it will happen, right? So the probability that it will happen is very, very high. So organizations that need to keep their data secure, although today it's still pretty good, the encryption that they have, but they don't know what the situation will be in 10 years from now. So if organizations need to keep records safe, like medical records or financial records or whatever, for extended periods of time into the future, they need to deal with this today, right?
Yeah, so think about, for example, I just recently got a new passport, which I think is valid for 10 years. Mm-hmm. So in your passport, there is some type of encryption. I'm not exactly sure what is used, but it has to remain safe for the next 10 years. So I am not convinced that within this 10-year time limit that quantum computers will be able to break this. So I think that this is already a security threat.
Yeah.
And of course, there are many more of these long-lived IoT devices. Think about cars. A new Tesla that gets on the road has to be on the road for what is it, 20, 30 years. Satellites that go into orbit maybe will be much longer into orbit. So you really have to think ahead, because it may be very difficult to upgrade the encryption.
Yeah, so that's the encryption part. Now, then you also have on this slide this quantum sensing. So that's a very specific, specialized field. But also there, quantum technologies will offer a huge increase in the precision, right? So can you say something about that? What kind of applications are these sensors used? Where is this relevant?
Yeah, so I did a master's in theoretical physics, but we also had this lab where we had this giant scaling tunneling microscope. It was the most advanced microscope that everyone used. And it's this huge machine, but it was extremely important for physics to measure all kinds of things. And what we are seeing now is that we are getting much more closer to getting sensors that are smaller and compact and higher accuracy and that we can just use for all kinds of industry applications. So think about anything that you can measure on the nanoscale: magnetic fields, electric fields, inertia. And create extremely careful measurements with it. So one example, which I already stated, is atom clocks that use extremely carefully measure the time. Mm-hmm. And you would say maybe this is a very specialized thing, but it's extremely important for GPS to measure your location. So new type of sensors that we will get in the next few years are based on measuring the magnetic fields. And there will be applications such as measuring the current through a electricity network and making sure that it's more adaptable for new renewables, my medical diagnosis apparatus that can measure like a sort of MRI, but then much more accurate, sensors that measure gases and maybe able to detect dangerous substances in the air. So a whole range of extremely careful sensors that we are smaller in size and hence applicable in industry.
Yeah. So basically, quantum technology offers huge opportunities. Quantum technologies offer huge opportunities, right? That's the promise. But then I also often hear people say, okay, but then what is exactly the challenge? Because we have seen this Moore's law operating for what is it, more than 40 years now, where every year or every 18 months basically our compute power doubles. So what's the big deal here? Now that we have quantum technologies, we have another maybe even order of magnitude increase in the capabilities of our computers. But then what's the big deal? Why should we start now? Why should we prepare? Why can't we just wait and see and why do we have to act now, Julian?
So I think that the answer is twofold. So one part is the impact will be huge. It will be in many industries, everywhere where there's a lot of compute power necessary, and which is, well, basically every industry now. And it will have a very significant change. So that's the first part, the impact. And second part, quantum technology is very different. It's from the most fundamental level, from the bits level and the quantum equivalence, the quantum bit, the qubits, there's a different way of programming. So we need new kinds of low-level programming languages and new types of frameworks, new types of applications, new types of developers. And this is not simple.
So this whole stack that we have known so long, it's going to change. So on every level of these stacks, things are going to change.
Yeah.
And so that's why we need to start building these capabilities right now.
Absolutely.
To be prepared when this technology finally arrives. So can you say a little bit about the applications of this technology, Julian? So where do you see the first applications of quantum technologies arise?
So one of the first areas where we would see applications is in quantum chemistry. So quantum chemistry is something that is extremely difficult to simulate with classical computers, especially if you are looking at molecules that have a lot of interactions. And there's a huge area that is that if we could simulate it, there would be a huge potential for it. So think about new type of catalysts that we could use in industrial processes. Think about stronger and better materials. At the moment, we can only simulate this with a lot of simplifications and a lot of to really make it the problem much smaller. And if we can simulate this without any simplification, and we will be able to scan thousands of molecules and thousands of substances, this may be a huge impact for a number of fields.
Yeah, but so also you say here on this lowest line, life sciences and healthcare. So that's where chemical simulations will work in the design of new medicines, maybe in the finding of better vaccines for diseases like COVID, etc. But then also you see applications in financial services, in automotive and manufacturing, improve battery design, right? That's also a material science or a chemical simulation kind of field. Energy utility, and then of course financial services for portfolio optimization and things like that. That also explains why we see already in the market, I think, from our clients, interest in quantum computing. We see it with banks. I know, Julian, you have been working with Rabobank, for instance, in the Netherlands. But we know that companies like JP Morgan and Goldman Sachs, they have significant groups of researchers looking into quantum technologies. For instance, it would make it possible that they have an algorithm today, but that they are only able to run every week or every month to, for instance, determine their position on the stock market. And now, because of quantum computers, they might be able to run it every minute or every second, basically increasing their visibility of market movements. Another thing that we should address, Julian, is so why is it important that Capgemini has to be in this area, right? Why can't we, until we have done so until now, just wait and see, and we will start building knowledge and capabilities as soon as clients start to ask for it? Why do we want to be ahead of the curve with this quantum lab?
Yeah. So compare it to AI. Quantum technologies may be in a similar place as where AI was in 2013 or 2010 or some like a few years ago. Back then, there wasn't too much client demand, but we knew that this is going to be extremely important for us. And I know that some of us, you know, thought that if we would have invested a little bit more then, we would have an even better position right now. And we are at the same point with quantum technologies as we were with AI. If we start to prepare now and get the right people involved, start to build some momentum internally, start to grow capability, we have an opportunity now to become first to market, to start experimenting with clients, to start attracting the right talent and to build the right talent internally. So I think this is really an important point that if we start preparing now, we have just a huge shot to play with this in the future.
Yeah, and so that's the overall goal of this quantum lab, as I understand it, is to become the number one system integrator in this quantum technology area. And to do that, we have to invest. So now, last point that we need to address, Julian, is how can people get involved? So we are talking here to a lot of people within Société. When people are fascinated by this area and when they're interested in this area, what can they do to get involved?
Right. So I'm working with a large group of extremely enthusiastic professionals within the global quantum community of Capgemini. And there's a whole bunch of fun things that we do. So we have these webinars every month. We have coding sessions, certification programs. There's a bunch of people getting certified in the IBM quantum programming language, Qiskit. and there's a whole things now. So we have some blogs and some other sessions with conferences. So there's a lot of momentum going on. So if people are interested in joining that momentum and learning about quantum technologies, then they can always reach out to me, and there's a community. And second, there is there is growing demand in the market. I think many of our clients are starting to realize this will be an important topic, and we really have something to show now. So if there is some client demand, then I think we will be happy to join in a conversation with them.
Okay, so now is the time to start exploring with clients where they have unsolvable problems, that the quantum approach might be a solution. Now's the time to start these conversations. So, Jeroen, thank you very much. This is all the time that we have today. I know that we could talk about quantum for days, but hopefully we have inspired the people, society, to take another look at quantum and hopefully get involved in this global quantum community. So thanks a lot, and hope to see you once more in a quantum webinar that we're organizing quite often for this community.
Thank you.